Hi guys, welcome to my channel. My name is Anuj Jindal. I'm a mentor for RBI Grade B Examination. Today I have with me rank 3 of RBI Grade B 2018. His name is Ali. So Ali, welcome to the show. Starting with rank 3, is it being padhaku or is it time management? What's the reason of getting such a high rank?
Like I've said this before and I'll say it again, nobody really aims for rank 1, 2 or 3. You clear the examination and then the rank comes after that. So padhaku nahi, maine pehle bhi kaha that's about time management. So I did have a full-time job for this. So you manage your time well, stay committed and then you do whatever you have to do to clear the examination.
Oh, perfect, perfect. Of course, nobody gets through, but there are some reasons which separates rank 1, 2, 3, etc. from, you know, the last rankers who also get to clear the examination, but there's a huge mark difference. So I think it's, other than being padhaku, it's a lot about the organization that you follow.
Yeah, most certainly. Like I said, it's about time management, right? You pick the way you want to study and then you do it every day. So the difficult part is not studying or what to study. It's about ke roz karna hai. It gets easier, but you have to do it every day. Eventually it gets easier, but the difficult part is doing it every day. So manage your time very well and eventually you will cover everything you need to cover for the examination.
So I read about your background and you moved a lot in school, different countries, not even in India. So what was the reason, what was the one thing that your parents always said? Was it like just clear this one and pass this one or clear this one and you're set for life, you're so smart?
And I think it's like it's every Indian's beta bus 10th ka exam hai. Every Indian family does this. Beta 10th ka exam hai, phir beta bus 12th ka exam hai, phir beta bus graduation hai. Oh, but beta then, they've got lots of betas to add to bus ye hai. So my parents, of course, being by virtue of being Indian, did add to that. But movement across schools, thanks to my father's job, has really shown me a lot around the world. So it's sort of fun that way. But one thing is constant, whether it's India or any other country I've seen, 10th and 12th, it's the same thing. Just work really hard, one time, one more time.
And it never ends.
And it never ends. I guess life is just these one times added up to many.
Yeah. So you have worked for the last 16, 17 months, you've been working in PNB. So, you know, a little bit about your experience in PNB, any good story or bad story that you would want to share?
Yeah. Working with PNB has been a lot of fun, actually. It is very different because this is a bank, but not only a bank, this is a special category of bank. So public sector banks in India are very different. Like this is not the plain vanilla banking because these banks have to fulfill a very important function, which is not usually in the nature of sort of, let's say, hardcore banking. We provide a essential public service to the public of India. We are the people's bank. We are there for the people. Wherever you go in India, even the most remote locations, you'll always find a PNB or an SBI over there. Because it's our duty to serve the people. Right? So, I mean, that's been very important. But in with all of this, we are bankers and we have to make the profit. I've learned so much that you can also do benefit. You can also do good to the people. At the same time, you can do your banking. I think that's a very good lesson I've learned. As far as my experience with PNB, of course, it's been wonderful. I mean, I spent my time in so many departments and learning. Like, I've learned more in these 9 months, 10 months for training and then this, afterwards joining the bank as a practical banker than I've learned through my entire coursework in academics. Because this is just invaluable. Not only do I learn how to deal with people, with problems, but at the same time, I'm evolving as a person, understanding what is dynamically affecting me and how I handle it on my own accord. So I think PNB has been very, very helpful in molding a personality that has shown me my own strengths with a greater light. So that sort of puts pressure on you. It sort of helps, makes you perform where you think you couldn't perform. I mean, staying, as you said, abroad for a long time, I do have some issues. I mean, I've never seen the interiors of India, rurals of India, but now I'm very confident that I can deal with anywhere I am. So PNB has been very, very helpful.
And what about the exam? Was it like helpful or was it a hindrance and how? Like, how did it help you clear the exam, if at all? How was it a hindrance in your preparation?
All right. Oh, so my job and my examination. Yes, all right. Yes. Yeah. Of course. I mean, the call of duty is always superior to anything else. If you're working, you have to work. I mean, I only got a week's leave before my prelims and a week's leave before my mains and no leave before my interview. So because that was because I am posted in like a very active area and my department, my working department is pretty active at the moment. And my own branch, which I'm in charge of at the moment, like it's very, very busy. And we're also pressed for staff at the moment.
Okay.
But this only adds to what I have to do. So I've learned to work in a smarter way. I learned to handle my branch in a better way. I've built more relationships at work that help me settle my work. At the same time, I've learned about commitment, that even if I come back home late after my work and my commute, I still give my 2 hours or 3 hours, even though it may not be that effective. But it's taught me about commitment, that I have to stick with the plan. So I mean, my job, like, I like, okay, so when I joined the bank, first week or so, our DGM in Lucknow, he told me, I told him that I am pretty young, I was 21 at the time. So he told me, you know, don't worry, this job will never be a hindrance as long as you have the right mindset. This job is going to be your strength that will push you forward. And I think it's most certainly in that area. That's the prospect it has given me.
He gave you the right advice at the right time.
He gave me the right, because most people, if they are working, they are utterly frustrated. And frustration and the will to leave a job could be fuel to prepare, but it's never enough. It will run out sometime. So you've got to have better reasons to prepare.
You're right.
Or to leave.
You're right. Makes sense. So now that we're talking about PNB, you must have got placed to different locations in your time period. So what are the challenges you faced in these locations while you were at it? And how did you manage preparing accordingly? Because I have a lot of students who come from, who are residing in rural areas, you know, working
myself
in some of the other,
yeah,
they don't have internet connection. They faced those kind of issues. So how did you deal with those kind of problems?
So my first 9 months in PNB was very, very, very sort of, you know, hustle bustle. I was, my base was Lucknow, but I would stay there for 3 weeks, then move out to some new branch for 6 weeks, come back to Lucknow for 3 weeks, again move out to a new branch. So I moved to Kanpur, I moved to Calcutta, I moved to Delhi, I moved to Aligarh. I've been stationary in Aligarh for about 7 months now. But prior to that, it was movement every third or fourth week. So I mean, of course, that's challenging. But at the same time, you get to see so many places. I mean, I enjoy going to all these places, looking at the locality, eating the food they have over there. I mean, each city in India, even if it's just a small distance away, like Kanpur, Lucknow, completely different food. So that helps out. As far as preparation's concerned, mostly rural placements do have an issue of connectivity, of internet. So for that, I mean, utilize that. I get somebody to print out your notes for you. Or if you write notes, if you don't have a course, if you don't have stuff. I mean, you've got to make arrangements for that. That cannot be an excuse, because no connectivity is a constant problem. Hence, you've got to solve it. You cannot bank on it and say, I can't prepare because I don't have an internet connection.
You're right.
That's the wrong attitude to go by.
You're certainly right. And in fact, a lot of students in UPSC get through every year from the rural areas.
Oh, yes. I mean, have you seen the movie Ratatouille?
Yeah.
Towards the end, he says that not everybody can be a great chef, but a great chef can come from anywhere. So not everybody can be, you know, great at whatever, but they can come from anywhere. So your place of posting should not be a restriction to whatever ambitions you have.
Wonderful.
I mean, that shouldn't be the case.
I'm sure the students who are watching this would like to know whether it's only books and stuff like that you're involved in, or books and work. Or do you have other hobbies as well? What exactly do you do in your
free time? As far as the truth can be, I mean, see, books, works, they're all there, and that's the primary thing. But that's not what you live for. I mean, I do have my hobbies. I'm a football fanatic. I watch football. I mean, every night, like if there's a football game on from United or Barcelona, because I support, like, Messi, big Messi fan here. I watch the game. Champions League, if it's at 1:30 at night till 4:30, I'll watch it and then go to work the next day. I do make allowances for the stuff I like. I used to play a lot of football. I don't do anymore and have the time for it. But I play guitar, watch movies. I do have my bit of fun that I used to relax. So I mean, it's not only that I study, because all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. And I'm certainly not that dull, so I won't put it that way. Because you've got to have something to help you stimulate your mind more than just books.
You're right.
Books are there. I mean, and even if you are reading coursework, you should read other than coursework.
You're right.
I mean, reading is an essential part of a good human being's development. There's so much to get from it. So, yeah, it's not just always books and academics. And I do have a lot more to myself than that.
And there has to be some way to get out that stress.
Yeah, I mean, of course, there has to be a positive way to relieve your stress. You cannot always have a negative outcome to it. I mean, you go for a run. If you don't go for a run, play guitar, meditate. 10 minutes of meditation is more than enough.
There are
so many ways to go about it.
So a lot of students face this problem because they feel that if they're preparing, they have to do just that. They don't have to, you know, have any hobbies. They have to give up everything in life.
No. If you're going at it that way, then you're doing it wrong. Because if you're willing to give up so much just for an examination, imagine if a bigger problem comes up than the examination, what else will you give up?
Right.
You've got to learn. It's a balancing act, I presume. And you've got to balance it. And you should know yourself better than that. I mean, and how much can one study? 4 hours at best? After that, it's just you are running on fumes, and then you're running on empty.
Yeah.
So learn to be effective in whatever you do, but at the same time, make room for yourself so that you can be effective later on and not just one time.
Yes, the consistency comes into play.
Consistency right? Plus, it's just that you need to have other avenues. You cannot one thing over and over again. I mean, anybody who's doing RBI should know this management theory.
Yeah.
What happens when a worker is just doing the one thing? He gets bored and there's lack of productivity.
Yes.
So you've got to do more than just the one thing. So more than just your job and your academics, you've got to do other things.
Yeah.
And they help you. They develop more. They develop a personality which is certainly required because life is more than just work. What if next day you join RBI and all you're doing is just working at RBI? What after that? You've got to have something that connects with other people.
You know, that reminds me of something. A lot of people who get into government jobs, either UPSC or RBI, let it be anything. You must have encountered those kind of people in PNB as well. They get through, they're very happy about it, but then they get frustrated immediately after that just because they lose that purpose and vision in life because the end was getting the job. Now, they're like, what after this?
I mean, that is a constant problem a lot of people do come across. But see, frustration because you don't like your job, then the answer is simple.
Change it.
Get a job you want to get, go work at. Or if the frustration is something else, maybe you aren't dealing well with your boss, maybe it's the place of posting, then these problems can be solved. But if it is that yes, you know for a fact that you can no longer work as a banker or you can no longer work in this particular firm, then make efforts to change it. Just simple frustration will not help you anyways, right? I mean, if the end motive of preparing for anything is just to get a job, I don't know how much can that fuel the motivation. Right, because there's got to be better purposes to study.
You're right. It's just not clearing an exam that can be the purpose.
No, it will not last that long.
Yeah.
You will be going at it. I want to clear. But the first roadblock comes your way and it's out the window. Nah, I'm fine. Aray, itna difficulty. I'll just stay where I am. So if you have a higher purpose, a better purpose, it'll help you leap over that blockage.
So what was your purpose when you
were? I know. So I've always wanted to go to the RBI ever since, like, I don't know, I picked up economics. I mean, my 11th grade classmates, whom I haven't spoken to in so long, I did grade 11 such a long time ago, they congratulated me after my selection that you used to talk about RBI so much back in the day and you're finally there.
Oh, amazing.
So, yeah, so I've always wanted to get there, just didn't know how. Picked it up. So despite being a banker at such a young age, I really wanted to make that shift. And I worked at it because an RBI is a place where you could see yourself. It's got so much to do. And being an economics graduate, personally, it's like the mecca of where an Indian economist can go. So most certainly, just the drive to be at RBI was sufficient and not frustration at my current job because it's all right.
So now that you've got into RBI, what now? Is it a postgrad in economics? Is it UPSC like a lot of people? So what's the future plan? Anything in your mind yet?
All bets are off at the moment. At the moment, I'm trying to just
enjoy, relax.
Not enjoy, just like take it all in, internalize it, assimilate it within myself, and then decide what step to take next. I mean, there could be multiple steps one could take. One could go for a post-graduation. One could, I don't know, use RBI to go abroad to IMF or the World Bank. I mean, there are so many options.
So many
I could choose to spend my entire life at RBI, which is a very viable proposition.
Of course, yeah.
So there are numerous steps. But at the moment, I just want to stay home, celebrate, get out of my current job, you know, take some time off for myself, and then I'll decide, hopefully. I'll let you know whatever happens.
Certainly, we'll stay in touch about that. Now coming to certain questions related to your preparation. So because you were always running short of time, did you join any course? If any, then how did it help you? How did it not help you? And what made you decide that you have to go for something and not do it all by yourself?
Well, I mean, most people know that I have subscribed to your course and that's why, you know, it's all there. But see, being pressed for time was the reason I subscribed to a course. The whole point about RBI is, especially, like, RBI is such a content-heavy thing. Like, it's got subjects. It's not just aptitude that mathematics or reasoning. It's got economics, social affairs, finance, management. Mm-hmm. Like, they are one paper, but there are different subjects altogether, right?
Mm-hmm.
These are four subjects plus English.
Mm-hmm.
There's so much to study from.
Mm-hmm.
And because I'm in a full-time job, I don't have the liberty of staying at home and researching my own material and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
So the entire primary purpose for anybody at this level,
mm-hmm.
be it UPSC or be it RBI or whatever, you know, postgraduate, like after graduation,
mm-hmm.
any exam you take, it's all about finding the resource. So if I have subscribed to your course,
uh-huh.
it's because you have collected all the material already.
Uh-huh.
I am paying for the material.
Uh-huh.
You are not coercively coming to me and teaching me, you know, in a classroom that you've got to do this ABC.
Uh-huh.
Studying is my job.
Uh-huh.
Finding the right resource is your job,
mm-hmm.
right? And that's how it goes by. So I took it because then I knew, okay, I've got this. I'll study this and I'll clear the examination.
Mm-hmm.
That entire journey of first finding the syllabus, then finding the right books, then finding the material out of those books,
mm-hmm.
and then finally studying.
Mm-hmm.
Nope, I skipped all of that. You did first ABC for me. I just did the studying part.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I would recommend that if people are pressed for time,
mm-hmm.
and they have a full time job, they should opt for a coaching. It's a lot easier that way.
Mm-hmm.
There are plenty in the market. They can choose anyone they like, and everyone offers some sort of thing. But
yeah.
the point is, if you're pressed for time, a coaching would be recommended. But
mm-hmm.
hey, people grade without coaching too, and it's not a must.
Of course.
Yeah.
And self-study is all the more important at the same time.
Towards the end, that's what matters, because
yeah.
even if I buy your course, that doesn't guarantee a seat in the RBI, right? I've got to actually read what you give me.
Yes. So moving on to phase one now. You've told the viewers a lot of time in the sessions that we've had in the past that you were always pretty strong in a lot of areas in phase one. So what was your, you must have some weak area which you must have encountered, and how did you tackle that?
Well, weak areas were mostly GA,
hmm.
because RBI has a specific nature of general awareness, which RBI does like. I mean, it's called GA, but it's completely different from what one would expect. And also to some extent, the reasoning which RBI asks,
hmm.
because the sets which RBI asks are particular to what RBI asks, and
hmm.
then usually not found in like CAT or other examinations.
Mm-hmm.
So I did work on that. GA, I've already mentioned, I've used a couple of sources. I used your material, which you handed out, plus
mm-hmm.
I used Banker's Adda.
Mm-hmm.
And I stuck to those two, because
mm-hmm.
I felt if I covered more ground with what I had was more useful than me finding more ground and not running in those grounds at all.
Yeah.
So put it that way. So it was a lot easier. I used a couple of sources. I stuck with those.
Mm-hmm.
For reasoning, I use a YouTube channel called Study Smart. That's
mm-hmm.
a very useful YouTube channel.
Mm-hmm.
That helped me understand all the caselets, like all the question sets, blood relation ka set ho gaya, ya phir circular arrangement or whatever sets, coding, decoding. That's a very bank examination kind of thing. Like other examinations, they don't have coding, decoding.
They don't have those questions.
Yeah. So that was particular sets. And I got myself, like, you know, familiar with those. Like, okay, if this comes up and if it's an easy one, I'll solve it. But if it's a difficult one, yeah, I'll just, you know,
just
let it slide by.
Mm-hmm.
So that's there. Plus, I took plenty of mocks.
So in GA, the main question that comes about is how to remember and recall everything, because there's so much out there.
See, unless you're Mike Ross from Suits, who has perfect recall, I don't think anybody will remember whatever they've read word for word.
Uh-huh.
Reading your source multiple times, again, like I said, covering the ground you have
uh-huh.
multiple times gives you enough of a memory. Plus,
uh-huh.
whenever you read the question, there's a strong trigger as to what the right answer is.
Uh-huh.
So it does help out. I mean, I haven't specifically sat down and tried to memorize page by page, word by word.
Uh-huh.
I just read through
uh-huh.
multiple times. And then
uh-huh.
when the question hits, those keywords give me that's, you know, ding 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 ding, that's the right answer, and you
mm-hmm.
go for it.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they have to, there's an allowance in GA for some wrong answers,
uh-huh.
because despite having that bell,
uh-huh.
you'll still get it wrong.
Yeah.
Hence the attempts have to be there, and you have to cover a lot more ground.
Yeah, so the intuition actually works, because you're,
it's not just intuition, it is proper backed intuition. It's at the back of your
yes,
mind, you've read
yes.
it somewhere.
Yes
that's how it is. It's not just a, okay, I'll give it a good shot at it.
So you don't have to mug up things, you have to probably repeat
your sources,
again and
highlight
again.
It if colors work for you, add it somewhere. Colors work, I don't know if they really work.
Uh-huh.
Use different highlighters,
uh-huh.
make a circle, write it down.
Uh-huh.
I don't know, do what works for you.
Yeah.
But at the moment, just reread your sources instead of trying to mug it up and just close the page.
So that's the trick. Yeah.
Yeah.
An important question arises, which is when to take the first mock. Should it be after you have started your prep with respect to phase one, or should it be before starting your prep and understanding where you stand?
I'd say take mock the first day.
Yeah.
That's what I did. I mean, because the utility of a mock starts with The fact that the mock gives you the entire paper in one go, there's no particular area.
Hmm.
And after that, you know where you stand. I mean, if you've got to make it to 100 and you're at 10, you know you have to go 90 steps.
Hmm.
Right? That's the most important thing. Do not lie to yourself that you can take care of it.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to be brutally honest with yourself.
Mm-hmm.
If you're pathetic at something, it's all right.
Yeah.
At least you can improve. At least you know. Like, the first step to solving a problem is recognizing there is one.
There is one.
And the mock tells you where the problems lie.
Yeah.
Post which you can make improvements to those areas. So
Correct.
If you take mock day one, I mean, I'd recommend candidates for 2019. They buy mocks on discount for 2018, skip the GA portion because the GA portion is redundant.
Mm-hmm.
Take the other sections.
Uh-huh.
And then they'll know if they're good enough for RBI's level of questions.
In fact, I put all the mocks of 2018 on the website so they can go and start
there
taking those
yeah.
mocks. Yeah.
Most certainly.
Certainly it's going to help them.
Because you just know, and it just puts you in a zone where you are comfortable with taking questions in a time, like in a timed manner.
Hmm.
It's not something like very new to you. Oh my God, I have to do that.
Hmm.
Fail in 100 mocks. I've mentioned this so many times. I mean, fail in 100 mocks. It's just a mock. Triumph on that one day when it matters.
Yeah, yeah. So you have to be very positive about those mocks. They're not there to take
yeah.
you down or pull you down. They're
yeah.
there to...
See, if you make mistakes, they have to be positive mistakes.
Yeah.
So for example, if you've made a mistake before,
hmm.
let's say you've done it, you shouldn't repeat that same mistake. Make a new mistake. Completely
yes.
fine.
Yes.
If you make a new mistake, you're covering more ground, you are learning.
Correct.
But if you make the same mistake, then there's something wrong.
There's something wrong, yeah.
Make new mistakes, that's completely fine.
Mm-hmm.
Because the more mistakes you make beforehand, on the final day, you wouldn't make
the less mistake. There would be.
That's,
certainly.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think that's the right way to go about it. Because the first mock you take, you probably will have 100 mistakes or 100
oh, yeah,
issues.
Yeah.
And you'll
come out thinking I'm the dumbest person there is.
Yeah.
But it's okay.
Yeah.
On that day, you are. But after 100 mocks, after 100 tries, yeah, you
mm-hmm.
won't be.
Correct.
The person who only took 10 mocks will be done then.
Okay, now moving on to phase 2. I see a lot of students trying to skip the syllabus, especially in finance and management, and moving towards
Big
the current.
Mistake.
So how important is the syllabus, and how much importance did you place with respect to time in covering the syllabus, covering the static portion for both finance and management in ESI?
No, so I think I discussed this with you when you started off preparing sometime in February, remember?
Mm-hmm.
I asked you where to start. You said finance.
Uh-huh.
And the first thing I did was I printed out the syllabus.
Uh-huh.
I had it in front of me.
Mm-hmm.
Let's start doing whatever the RBI asks me.
Mm-hmm.
I should at least do that. I mean, if I want to study extra stuff, at least do what RBI has asked you to do,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So print out the syllabus, get what you've done, and I cover FM. So finance and management, you've got to cover it beforehand, simply because when the day comes,
mm-hmm.
this is static stuff. This will not change. This is theory. This is
yeah.
concepts. They can be done beforehand and revised towards the end, because towards the later half of your preparation, a lot of time will be dedicated to the ESI general awareness.
Right.
Because there's just so much content to cover over there, right?
Okay.
So when you've got this much content to cover towards the later half
uh-huh.
of your preparation, it's better you take out the easy bits.
Uh-huh.
The bits which will not change, the static bits,
uh-huh.
when you're starting off. So
uh-huh.
that towards the end, you just have to quickly revise and move on with it.
So what you're saying is cover the static portion.
Yeah, no, cover FM. Like start your preparation with FM.
Uh-huh.
So that when you've covered so much of FM, every mock you take will not only be an FM revision, but will give you the comfort that you're good with FM.
Uh-huh.
At the same time, every mock you take for phase 2 will add to your current affairs in your ESI. So FM must be the starting point for all people, because this, number one, not only helps you understand many concepts from finance and stuff, which will be helpful in understanding economic current affairs.
Yeah.
But at the same time, this will give you the comfort that you have one paper ready. All you've got to do is put your focus on ESI, which is
mm-hmm.
in itself a very difficult task.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's no end to that paper.
Mm-hmm.
They can ask you anything and everything which the government of India does. And the government of India does a lot,
yeah.
contrary to popular belief.
Yeah. So what it is doing is it is psychologically preparing you for the exam, at the same time helping you to cover more ground in a
yes.
smaller amount of time, because you're covering the syllabus.
You're overlapping it. I mean,
yeah.
since I was so pressed for time, I had to do this kind of stuff where
mm-hmm.
I did a lot more in less time.
Uh-huh.
So it had to be strategized that way.
Yeah.
I mean, management, this there at CPM, critical path management, where you overlap certain tasks to make
yeah.
it go in the same time.
You find the least amount of time and the least amount of
yes, yes. That is, so when people talk of strategy, it's not about what to study, where to study, but also how I would study it.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I plan my day to every whatever 5 minute gap even I can find when I'm doing, like, after work I'll be, if I'm work at this time, then I come back home, half an hour for food, half an hour for some TV and rest, 2 hours for study. Is within the 2 hours, if I've got to put half an hour for this, then 5 minutes break, then I'll do this. It's planned to that sort of a degree so that I can quickly overlap things and study them at the same time. So I mean, that is what I would call strategizing, rather than just भैया ये बता दो कि ये कहाँ से पढ़ना है वो कहाँ से पढ़ना है. I mean that everybody can do. I think that really changes the game when you put that much emphasis on what you're going to study and how.
Right. So you had a daily planner where you would, you know.
No, I do it in my head.
It's
I wouldn't sit down and write it. I mean, most people do recommend writing it down because when you write down your goals, like, it's in proof. But I was a little lazy. Plus, I had to take care of work and other things, so I would do it in my head. But I would constantly do it when I'd come back. Even at work, I've got to cover this, I've got to cover that, topic-wise. So every, like, even the 20-30 minute window of study would be pre-planned. And nothing would be, I'm just going to wing it today. Because I would start winging it only when I've done enough, so I can start revising it.
Correct.
But if I'm studying, I've got to plan it every bit of the way.
So the next question is the challenges that you face while you were preparing. Because a lot of students who are preparing now facing, probably facing the same challenges. So you listed out 4 challenges to me, and I'm going to, you know, point them out one by one, and you can tell me how exactly did you tackle those challenges. So the first was finding and identifying the right sources that you had to study. So how did you tackle that challenge?
Good bit of research on Google, saw the RBI stuff, saw what other toppers did prior, you know, to what they did. They listed out some sources, then I, you know, had a look through all of them, picked the ones I liked. I mean, I had a course, so that was like a source to go with. Other than that, everyone recommended Vision IS. So I picked up Vision IS, Insights on India. These two were good sources. So that's how I would tackle, I mean, finding sources. Because the thing is, the source is what you agree with. There are multiple sources, but what you sort of understand and what you think, what you have a feeling for, that is a good source, makes it a source. Because some people would recommend different sources and be like, nahi achhi nahi, but it works for them. So you really can't find faulty sources.
So you have to make sure that you like the source.
And it's to your satisfaction.
Yes.
I mean, that really pays off in that way.
I think that's very important.
Yeah.
So the next challenge that you pointed out is the challenge of taking out time. And I think we've talked about it.
I mean, time management has got to be very, very, you've got to be downright disciplined with time management. I mean, I am not that disciplined, but then when it comes for this examination, I had to, because I really wanted to make it to RBI. So, I mean, it doesn't have to be that you've got to be like this downright time management alien, but you've really got to, you know, step up where it counts. So if it's 4.5 months, that can change your life. 5 months, why not be disciplined for those?
You're right. Makes sense. What about anxiety? You must have had a lot of anxiety issues.
Anxiety is always, it's like a running part. It's not just about an examination, like your job, your place, personal life, professional life, whatever. I mean, to deal with anxiety, you deal it in a positive manner. So if something's pulling you down, you try and avoid it. I mean, my dad was talking to me the other day. He said, you know, when things don't add up, you start subtracting. You know, like, start cutting down people, start cutting off things, start, you know, getting rid of bad habits. So, I mean, you deal with anxiety in a positive manner. Your response to stuff that's troubling you should be which benefits you. Otherwise, it's just more difficult. It's just like a serious, it goes into a graver issue than just what it was initially. Plus, the anxiety for studies, then just study some more. And also have some confidence in yourself.
Yeah.
You cannot say, I've studied 25 hours a day out of 24. And then be like, oh, it's not working out. No. You've got to have some belief that you'll do well. That's why you're putting in the effort.
So I think it all accumulates. You put in, like, probably, let's say, 4 hours per day for the next 6 months, and it accumulates and helps you out.
It's no particular formula, 4 hours per day. For 180 days, what does it add up to? What, 720 hours? That's a lot of hours. I didn't think I put those many hours. But, I think a good bit of self-discretion. Like I've said before, the difficult part is doing it every day. Not doing it. Doing it every day, day after day, is the difficult part. The actual stuff gets very easy. It gets so much easier after some time. But you've got to do it every day. And that's the difficult
consistency
part.
Consistency matters a lot. And the last doubt...
Persistence matters.
Yes. Persistence matters a lot. And the last doubt is this doubt of, you know, self-belief or belief in yourself.
That's like a very pertinent question, because okay, so when people look at some profiles, they go, oh, throughout topper, IIT, IIM, and only these guys make it. It's not true. It's not true.
Mm-hmm.
This batch, I haven't met all the friends because we have not joined yet, but we are in touch via WhatsApp group. We've got people from everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
There are very young people like me.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a guy, I think he's 22 as well. I mean, I'm 23. He's about 6-8 months younger than me.
Mm-hmm.
We've got a guy who's leaving JP Morgan for this.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got what? Investment bankers, we've got students, we've got an entire pool of people.
Uh-huh.
And not everyone's from an IIM or this was from an IIT.
Mm-hmm.
These are all, I mean, of course, you'll always have some geniuses everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how it is.
Mm-hmm.
But only geniuses? No, that's not the fact. These are all simple, hardworking people who give it what they have in a very, you know, precise, disciplined manner. And they make it there because they believe in that. So that their hard work will pay off. If not here, then somewhere else.
Correct.
Hard work doesn't go to waste. If you don't have it this time, tough luck, because luck, I mean, boatloads of luck is needed.
Yes.
But understand that hard work always pays off. If not here, then somewhere else.
Somewhere else, yeah.
Yeah, most
and
certainly.
You must have some people from a very humble and very basic background.
Yeah, yeah, I mean,
normal education.
I met half these people for the, like, so during my interview, I met a couple of guys who did make it.
Uh-huh.
And they're all just normal people. When you would go and talk to you, you'd probably go and sit with them. They'll have water and drinks and they'll be like talking nonsense.
Uh-huh.
Because I remember during the interview time, one of them did, so we were all sitting around, half of them had the interview to go and the other half had taken the interview. They were just waiting for us to go and take the interview.
Uh-huh.
And we spoke utter nonsense. We were just talking proper nonsense, like
nothing
to do with RBI, economics or whatever one would presume all these hotshot people talk about.
Just like 18-year-olds. Yeah.
Worse than 18. Like, this was so bad. And then one of them did point it out. I think so. Somebody pointed out that what if RBI has put a mic and camera here? We'd all be so screwed.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're all normal people, but we are dedicated when it counts.
Yeah, I think
and that's what you should
that,
do.
That's what matters.
Yeah.
So, to finish, let's have a rapid-fire round to see, to know more about
coffee
you.
With Karan, it seems.
Probably. The book you like the most, both fiction and non-fiction, I think that matters to a lot of people.
Fiction's got to be Tolkien.
Okay.
Yep, definitely. Okay. Lord of the Rings, it's got to be Tolkien. Non-fiction, there are plenty of books because I primarily read non-fiction.
Mm-hmm.
But I think, yeah, The Alchemist, but by Neil Irwin. It's the one about central banking. It's the one about the 2008 crisis, not the Paulo Coelho one. No, not
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's The Alchemist by Neil Irwin. It's a very interesting read about how the three central bankers, the one from England, the one from Europe, and the one from USA, how they saved the world.
Oh.
And it's a pretty intense read. I would advise everyone to read.
Is there sarcasm on them? Or
No. They did save the world.
Oh, really?
They did save the world.
I love to read that.
Yeah, please.
If you get a chance to settle down in or outside India, where would that be?
Oh, certainly India. I've seen so many different countries, but home's home, man.
So what's
home's
what's,
home?
What's different about the country?
Everything. I mean, it's got my people, it's got my language, it's got my food. I mean, I can stay anywhere, but I'd always be called Indian. My kids would be called Indian origin.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm still Indian and I'll forever be Indian. So, yeah,
so
definitely.
No matter how many imperfections we have, I think.
No. Everybody's got problems.
Yeah.
But it's still home. Home's home, man.
Perfect.
I'll stay here, work at it, spend my life here. Not a problem.
Yeah. Raghuram Rajan or Kiran Bedi?
Raghuram Rajan. No,
why?
No question. Raghuram Rajan. In grade 11, I was... So what had happened? So, like I said, my grade 11 was abroad.
Mm-hmm.
So amongst like all these international students, you sit. There are people from France. There are some Italian people. And you're the Indian guy. And we were studying economics.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I started Googling people. Like, you know, like famous Indian economists. Come on. Who are the people in the area I'm studying? And Amartya Sen popped up. And then Raghuram Rajan.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, Raghuram Rajan. Back then he was the chief economist at the IMF. And I'm like, guys,
right.
We just studied IMF and Raghuram Rajan's in there. He's an Indian.
Uh-huh.
And then like 2013, when I'd done my 12th grade, he became the RBI governor.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, oh my word, I've got to go to IMF. Like Raghuram Rajan, like, that's it. So Raghuram Rajan, like you put anybody after that, it's Raghuram Rajan.
Leaving the IMF, coming to India.
Yeah. There we go.
Governor
of
RBI,
you've
got to be there.
Yeah.
Certainly. Last message to students, what would that be?
Like what? Message for life or like message for the examination?
Message for the examination, certainly for now.
Okay, so message for examination, that take a lot of marks. Don't be afraid of marks.
Uh-huh.
Your mocks will help your preparation. Even if you score a zero,
mm-hmm.
it's completely fine.
Mm-hmm.
Because plenty of people, they are afraid of taking mocks.
Uh-huh.
And then they miss out the opportunity to learn from a mock. Because at the end of the day, preparation is all about learning before you finally take that test.
Yeah.
So take as many mocks
as possible. So we had a lot of fun today, and I'm sure we had a lot of valuable information coming from Ali as well. If you like this video, subscribe to the channel, and all the very best for the examination. Study hard. Take care.